with every day. And today, he's going to tell us how to write a perfect story.
First of all, thank you for inviting me here. And it's a wonderful opportunity to talk with such a lovely crowd in the house. And first, as a second, I want to welcome Google here. The startup ecosystem in Bulgaria just gets more and more exciting every day, and I think you'll find some really interesting stuff here in the most fun to live capital of Europe.
You're right.
Okay, so let's begin. Writing the perfect story. There is no such thing like a perfect story, but here we're going to talk about user stories. User stories as a requirements technique. How many of you are involved in software projects? Please raise your hand. Okay, so five guys will get some value inside our next keynote, and I hope the rest will be at least amused. Okay, in software development there are two, let's say, supernatural forces. The first supernatural force is that of the business. These are the people who won't need the software. They have identified the business need, the consumers, the opportunity, and they need the software getting built. But they cannot build it themselves. The developers are the guys who build the software. So these supernatural forces need to get along in some way. The requirements, elicitation is a communication challenge. I hope you get the joke. It's a simple problem, but what could possibly go wrong in this communication challenge? Let's briefly touch on these. It's, this is how a software project looks. This guy on the wire is the software project. The buildings are the development and the business. It's a balanced act, and it's the balance is critical. It's a balance of power. Basically, we run into these situations where at least one of the parties gets more power. For example, if the business dominates the communication, the project, the power in a project, what would happen is that the business guy says, I need this by this date, make it so. Disregarding all engineering realities. And that's not a nice thing to say to a friend, considering sticks are friends. By the way, I haven't used Larry and Sergey on the slide first, because they read each other's minds. They just work in tandem. They're a couple, they're psychic. And it's completely different dynamic. They don't have this problem. Obviously. When the developers dominate, what they do is they invade the project and the whole communication, the technical jargon. And the bottom of it is they say, okay, I'll build whatever you want, just write the specification for it, but 300 pages of specification will do, and just don't bother me talking to you and to this business stuff. I don't like it. I like building stuff, I don't like talking about business with you, and I don't like business people at all. So it's not a very healthy relationship, right? And if you keep the balance, magical stuff happens. So this is the first problem, balance of power. The second problem, that's a problem Google doesn't have. The resource test problem. So who's responsible about that? You have a big project, but just a few developers to build it. Whose responsibility is the resource allocation? Again, if we decide that it's test responsibility, what they do is usually trade quality for feedback, trade quality of features, and they do partial implementation, like miss couple of corner cases, and they solely make decisions without involving the business, without involving the other part. They're just doing what they want. On the other side, if the business is on top of this, they usually do lengthy form requirement negotiation. They want a precise date to have all decisions taken. And progressively, as the deadline nears, they progressively drop features. With assume that. Okay, that's second problem. And the third, how many of you have done estimations? Do you love this thing? How do you feel when you do estimations? It's really, really uncomfortable experience. So estimations are real. New ideas come up all the time. Business needs to be flexible. It needs to react to business reality and to world realities, instead of just following something written on paper. There are too many intangibles. There are too many things that might affect the schedule. And it's very complex, even for people who have a lot of experience. But we need to understand as developers that if we don't do an estimation, we cannot bring to the table the topic of discussing the scope, of doing potential trade-offs, of discussing this. So estimations are important. In this communication problem, there are three problems. If you combine these three problems, what you get is an impossible puzzle. How do we solve impossible puzzles? Here is a small recipe. Two rules that I will share with you, and you need to follow without question. Rule number one, make decisions based on what is known, not on what is unknown. Very simple. Rule number two, avoid making one all-encompassing set of decisions. Instead, spread them across the timeline of the project. If you don't know something, you don't have to make a decision. You just refuse to make a decision. Explain why you're not making the decision. Bring all the available information on the table. Business people are smart people too, even though they're not developers. And for rule number one, remember to do it often. I mean, even if you take a decision, after a week, just look over it, see what's changed, see what information you have as new information, reconsider the decision, and take decisions often. Okay, so here is where stories come in. Stories are usually a concise description of the customer environment card used as a unit of work on an agile project, but not necessary. You can use it in whatever project. It's just a technique for requirements, elicitation, for building relationship with the business, for building a healthy relationship with the business. It serves as a placeholder for a collaborative conversation between the customer and the team. It's a media for conversation. It's not just a card on which a simple sentence is written on. It's a media for conversation and collaboration. It's a placeholder for this conversation and collaboration to happen. You need to, when you start realizing this, and when you start applying this in project, you see a huge difference in the project output. Okay, so let's see the components of the story. Usually, a user story has a few components. It starts with an index card. It's just a sentence in the form of, as a someone I want to do, I want to accomplish a goal so that I can deliver for me or for someone else some values. A story that has sub-stories, it has a bunch of participants. This little thing in the corner, this is the card. The card is disposable, the card can be rewritten, the card can be negotiated. So this is the first component of the story. The second component of the story is a conversation. Here you identify the stakeholders that can influence the outcome or that, you know, are important to elicit the details, and you just get them on the table and talk to them. You talk to them and you cover what kind of details. Like, for example, you have open questions, you have tech-related discussion, you have design and interaction, etc. Whatever it is part of the conversation. And the last component of the story is the confirmation. A story is unfinished until the business says, this is what I consider this story done. These are the things that tells me that the story is complete. It's a confirmation, even if you do all the conversation without the business or with some other parties, at the end, you need to bring the business in and you just demand from him a confirmation. So this things are the known as the three C's of the story. I'm finished.
Trust.